Hello everyone, welcome to our YouTube channel Testing Gyan. In our today's video, we are going to learn about few commonly used keywords in Java. The first keyword in the list is new keyword. So new keyword is used at the time of class instantiation and it helps to allocate memory to the objects at the runtime. Now let us see how it is done in the code. In our class and objects video, we discussed about the person class, where we defined the state of an object using the variables and the behavior of an object using the methods. Now we have to create an object which will hold this state and behavior. Now in Java, defining or creating an object is a two-way process. The first part is declaration and then the second part is instantiation and the initialization. Now let us take a look how it is done. So the first part, declaration, is like class name and then the reference variable name. So this is declaration. Now the second part is instantiation and initialization, which is done with the help of new keyword. So I will type new and then the class constructor name, and this is how it is done. So this particular statement is used for the instantiation of class, where new keyword is used to allocate memory to the object at the runtime and to invoke the class constructor. Now if I run this program, as soon as I run this program, at the runtime new keyword would allocate memory to the object of this class, which is this, and this reference variable will hold these values, these variable values, somewhere in the heap area, that is age equal to 0, name is equal to null, gender is equal to null, because we are using the default constructor and all of these values are initialized to their default values. So this is how new keyword is used in Java. Apart from this, new keyword can be used directly in the expression like this. That is, instead of class reference variable, we can directly use the new keyword to allocate the value to some variable in the class. And it is also used for the array initialization, because array is also an object. So this is how it is done. So this was all about the new keyword. Now let us move to the next keyword, which is static. So static is a non-access modifier in Java, which is mainly used for the memory management. Static is associated to the class and not to the object of the class. It gets memory once in the class area at the time of class loading, and it is accessible to the all the objects of class. Static is mainly used in programming language when we want to refer to the common properties of an object which are not unique. Now let us take a look at an example to understand more about this. To understand this, I have created this example where I have declared one variable integer a, and I have created the class constructor where I am incrementing that variable and then I am printing it. Now in my main method, I have created three objects. Now if I run my this program, as it is a non-static variable, every time when I create an object, a new memory allocation happens. So every time my variable a is initialized to 0, and then within the constructor it is incremented and is printed as 1. So you can see all the objects at the time of all the three instantiation statement, it is printed as 1. Now if I make this variable as static, as we know, like, static gets memory only once at the time of class loading, and now if I run this program, so you can see it has printed 1, 2, 3, because on the first instantiation statement the memory is allocated not at the time of this instantiation, memory is already allocated to static variable at the time of class loading. So at first statement it is incremented to 1 and then it printed the value, and then on the second statement it is incremented to 2 and printed the value, and then to the 3. So this is how static works in Java. Static keyword in Java can be used with variable, method, block and the nested class. The static block and static variables in Java executed in the order they are present in the program, and a constructor can't be a static, because constructor is associated to class object, whereas static is associated to the class. Now let us see how it is done in Java. Now let us see how static block is used. To understand this, I have created this example where I have declared one static variable, and then I have created a static block where I am initializing the static variable, and then a constructor, and then the main method. In main method, one print statement, and then the class instantiation. Now if I run this program, the very first call will go to the static block. Even before the main method, static block will be called and A will be initialized to the 100, and it has printed in the console the value of A, and then the call went to this sys statement. That is, call went to the main method and it printed out the main method, and then the constructor call because of this class instantiation. So this is how static block can be used. Static block and the static variables always executed in the order which they are declared. That is, even before my static block, this variable was executed, this static call was executed. So just to take a look at this, I am going to create one more example. Now let us see. Now in this example, I have created one more variable, static variable b, which is taking its value from this static method, and it is set to 20. Okay, and I am having a static block. Now if you see, if I run this program, the first call will be to the static method. That is, my static variables and static block are executed in the order in which they are present, as we can see in the console logs. Now this was all about the static keyword. Now let us move to the next keyword, which is final keyword. Now final is another non-access modifier in Java, which is used to restrict the user, and it can be used with variables, class and methods. Now let us see what I meant by restricting the user by taking an example in Eclipse code. To understand this, I have created two classes, final1 and final2. In my final1 class, I have written this code where I am declaring one final variable int a equals to 10, and I have created one method where I am simply printing the value of that variable. Now if I run this code, you can see it is printing 10 in the logs. Now if I want to change the value of this variable, and I make it something like this, a++, now you will see my compiler will throw me an error, which is, it is telling me final field a cannot be assigned. So this is how final is restricting the user to change the value of the variable. So that is, if a variable is declared final, its value can't be changed. Note even here, even if I pass the variables as a method arguments here like this, int a, final, int d, and if I try to change the value here, c equal to c plus 10, so you will see compiler is even throwing me error here as well, because even the arguments are declared final. So this is how final restrict the user. That is, final can not let me change the value of the variable. Similarly, if I declare the method as an final, I can't override that method. So in order to override method, I have to go to the another class. So I have created one final2 class where I am extending the previous class. That is final1 is the parent class of final2. Now if I try to override my method here, same method, void method, you will see it is throwing me an error, because the same method is already created in this class and it is made final. So that is why I can't override it. If I remove final from here, you can see the error is gone. Similarly, if I make the class name as final, public final class, if I make my class as final, you will see I can't even extend my class. So this is how final restricts user from changing the value of variable, overriding the method and extending the class. So this was all about the final variable. Now there are two other things. The next thing is, like, final variable if I am not initializing my final variable, then where exactly I can initialize that variable? I can initialize that final variable only within the constructor. Now compiler is throwing me an error telling me to initialize the integer a. So I can initialize that variable, that is non-initialized final variable, within my constructor. Okay, you can see error is gone. Similarly, if I make this variable along with final, I make this variable as static as well. So you can see, like, if I make this variable static, it is throwing me error like variable may not have been initialized, and here it is giving a cannot be assigned here. That is, I can't initialize static final variable in a constructor. For that I have to create a static block, and here I can initialize my variable. So this is all about the final keyword. Now let us move to our next keyword. The next keyword in our list is the this keyword. This is a reference variable that refers to the object of current object of the class. So this keyword can be used in number of places. Like, it can be used to refer to the current class instance variable, then it can be used to call the current class constructor. It can be passed as an argument in method and constructor call. Can be used to invoke current class method. Can be used to return the current class instance. Now let us go through few of these usages one by one. So I have created this example to understand all the usage of this keyword. The first usage is it refers to the current class instance variable or the object or the reference variable. Now let us see how it impacts. Now here, to understand this, I have declared two variables, int a and int b, and then I have used a parameterized constructor to pass on the values, whatever the value I'm going to pass them through my instantiation statement here. Okay, now if I run this program, ideally it should print value, whatever the value I'm passing from my parameterized constructor, which is 10 and 20 in this case. But if I run this program, you will see it is printing 00. Even when I am passing value as 10 and 20, it is printing 00. This is because the current reference is to the default constructor, and because of that it is printing the value 00. To point out to this reference, which is the current reference of this class, we have to basically use the this keyword, this dot a. Either I have to use this keyword in this case, or I have to change the name of these variables which are there in the argument. I can change them to int c and d, and then I can make it like a equal to c, b equal to d. In that case also it will work. So if I run this program now, you will see it has printed the value 10 and 20. So this is how this can be used to refer to the current class reference, that is the current object of the class. Now the second usage is to invoke the current class method. So I have created one more method, method 1, where I am calling the print method using the this reference. So in this case it's not mandatory to add this reference here, this keyword here, because compiler by default will add this in the backend. So now if I run this, if I call this method 1, you will see it will print the values of the a and b, because in method 1 itself I am calling the print method. Now this can also be used to call the current class constructor, either calling the parameterized constructor in the default constructor or calling the default constructor in the parameterized constructor. So for that I have created this default constructor here. Here I have created the default constructor where I am setting the value in the parameterized constructor, this using the this keyword, this 40 50. So if I run my program now, I will comment out this statement, and I will create a new reference variable which is invoking the default constructor. And if I call the print method using the second reference variable, it will print the value 4050. Why 4050? Because as soon as I created the instantiation for the default constructor like this instantiation, then it went to the default constructor here, and here I am calling the parameterized constructor using the this keyword, and I have stated value as 40 and 50. So that is why when I call the print method, it printed value 40 and 50. So this is how this keyword can be used for the constructor call. Likewise, we can use this keyword to pass as an argument in method, pass as an argument in constructor, and even to return with the return statement to get the current reference of the class or the current object of the class. So this was all about the this keyword. Now let us move on to the next keyword in the list, which is super. Super is a keyword in Java which refers to the immediate object of the parent class. It came along picture along with the concept of inheritance, and it is used to refer to the parent class instance variable, and it is used to invoke parent class method and constructor. Now let us see how it is done in Java. To understand this, I have created these two classes, Super1 and Super2. Super1 is a parent class where I have specified the constructor Super1 and printing simply that this is a Super1 class constructor, and then I have created one variable int a equals to 10 and then a method which is printing that it is a super class 1 method. Now in the second super class, which is a subclass, and I have extended the super 1 here, that is super 1 is the parent class and super 2 is the subclass. Now in this class I have declared one variable int a equal to 20, and then I have created the constructor call. So in super 2 class constructor, that is a subclass constructor, by default compiler will add the statement super which will call the parent class constructor. Even if I am not adding it, compiler will add it. So let us take a look at it. Now in the super 2 subclass main method, I have created this reference variable. I have instantiated it and I have called the method which is currently not there. Just ignore this statement. So once I run this program, you can see the first call went to the parent class constructor and the second call went to the child class constructor, which is this one. So if I include this statement here, it will be the same result. There is no change is going to be in the output. So this is what compiler adds the first statement in the subclass constructor is super, which will call the parent class constructor. Now let us understand where else we can use the super keyword. That is, we can use the super keyword to call the parent class variables. We can use the super keyword to call the parent class method as well. So let us see that. So for that, I have created this method, okay, where I am first calling the printing the value of a variable as per my current class, and then I am using the super keyword to print out the value of the parent class a variable. So in my child class variable a value is 20 and in my parent class variable a value is 10. Now if I call this method in my main method and I run this program, you can see the output is first call is to the super class constructor, that is the parent class constructor, then the child class constructor or subclass constructor, then it called to the method, and in the method first it printed the value of variable a in the subclass itself, and then using the super keyword it printed the value of the parent class variable a, which is 10. Similarly, we can use this super keyword to call the parent class method as well. So this is the method in parent class where I am simply printing super class 1 method. So if I run it, so you can see first call is to the parent class constructor, then subclass constructor, then parent class subclass method, which is this print statement, and then printing the variable a of child class, then printing the variable a of parent class using super keyword, then printing the print statement in the method of parent class, which is called using super class. So this is how super keyword can be used in Java. Now the next and the last keyword in the list is return. It is a reserved keyword in Java and used to exit method, or basically used to complete the method execution. This is the syntax for the return keyword, and value returned using the return keyword must match with the return type of the method. It is not required to use return keyword along with the method which is not returning anything, or it is having the return type as void. But even if you include like this return, then ending the statement, that will work, that will not have any impact. Now let us see with the example. To understand this, I have created this code where I am having two methods, method and method 2. Method 2 is having the return type as void, and method is having the return type as int. To match the return type of method, I have returned the value 20, which is an integer value. If I make it something like this, that is, it is returning the string value, you can see it will throw the error that cannot convert from string to int. That is, the return statement, the value which I am returning with the help of return statement or return keyword, is not matching with the return type of method. That is, it is very important, whatever we are returning should match with the return type of the method. So this is how return statement can be used. Okay, and if I am not using the return statement, even then it will throw me the error, because I have specified the return type of the method, so I have to give the return statement. It's not mandatory that this return statement should be the last statement in the method, but it is mandatory that this return statement should be executed at the end of this method, so that method execution is complete. Now the second method is void. That means the return type of this method is void, which means it is not returning anything. So if I am not including anything here, that is fine. And if I want to add the return statement, then I can make it something like this. That will also have no impact. It is also indicating that this method is not returning anything. So this is how return can be used in the Java. So this was all about the most commonly used keywords in Java. I hope you guys are able to understand. In case you have any questions, please post over the video comments. We will try our best to answer those questions.